Jyoti Bhatt, it's really wonderful sort of sitting in your home because I had the privilege, being your student for so many years, to have been in many of your homes in the university and later when you built your own homes. And home is something that's always the best representation of who we are. It tells us about many subtle things about the kind of people we are. So it would be interesting maybe for us to talk about home and its influences, starting perhaps with what is fundamentally the first influence, which is our parents. So I do know that your father has been a very outstanding person within his own community, somebody who held principles and values that were important and relevant for the time that of a political space in India. So maybe we can start and maybe you can pull out some reminiscences of that.
What I know about my father, you know, is what I have heard from others. You know, his family members were elder than my father. His mother died when he was very young, you know, maybe 4 or 5 years old. And his father was, that's my grandfather, was in the police department, you know, of Pavanagar state. So he had to go on traveling. So my father was, I think he spent more time with his grandfather. And I've got this influence that my great-grandfather was, in a way, he had a better kind of open outlook towards life then, no, though being from Orthodox Brahmin family, than my grandfather. So he learned many things from my great-grandfather, who was an excellent cook, so my father became also, he had to, because there was no mother, no? So wherever they were traveling, he had to cook. He was not interested in schooling much, and when he was about, 12, 13 or so, he ran away from his house, no? He had read, I understand, I've heard this, that there was a public garden, and instead of going to school, they would go to public garden and eat some, what we call chawana, titbits. And then, they were using newspapers for making those pudiya. And he saw there was some mention about some course in Kalabhavan in Baroda, where one could learn some craft. So he ran away and perhaps went to Kalabhavan, that is, came to Baroda here. And I don't know what happened. Eventually he went to Surat and he had no place where to go. So he was working with somebody, I think some shop who was making namkins. And somehow or other, because his father was police department, they knew how to find people who were away from their own home. And he had to go back. So then my grandfather understood that he was not interested in schooling anymore. And he joined one workshop. Bhavnagar was a port. And that workshop was there to repair ships. And because the creek of Bhavnagar has, I think, perhaps it's considered highest in the world, the difference of high tide and low tide. And it brings so much muck. So then the ships were unable to come. So they had to have some special ship that would dig the clay and throw away, far away in sea. So that was there, and then so he started with the lowest, whatever was the rung, breaking coal, etc. And eventually they had a British port officer And somehow or other, my father was attracted to his way of working and discipline, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he started learning many things, and eventually he was at the top, you know, later.
Mm-hmm.
Now, during that time, you know, the influence of Gandhi was very much there. And he became partly Gandhian. I mean, he didn't believe in non-violence.
Okay.
In fact, working in a factory made it easy for him to make bombs because they had all the machineries, you know. And they could pretend to do something for ships and repairing ships, but making some parts.
Mm-hmm.
I also understand that there was some revolutionary from Bengal who had come to Bhavnagar, in underground, and he was teaching these people. These people means my father and the group of people who were working with him.
Mm.
But he was very, in a way, he insisted on discipline. He insisted that everyone should do his duty, you know,
mm.
and also should enjoy rights. So he had to fight with Bhavnagar state
mm-hmm.
for the rights of the laborers. Because otherwise they were on what we call daily wages, no? So instead of that, they became regular employee.
With benefits.
And provident fund and whatever things.
But
he also wanted workers not to be late even 5 minutes. No, he would not allow. So there was that kind of what you call dichotomy.
Dichotomy and conflict, yes.
He formed a group which was he called Anand Mangal Mandal, that you do things for your own joy, but it should be such that it does mangal, good things for others, for the society. And they were all laborers, and that's how that group started. And they started kind of a school in one slum area. And then this was earlier when he was staying in a house which his grandfather had built, where there were four families. That's my grandfather and three uncles.
Mm.
They all had houses. There was one common open area in center and four houses on four corners. But then Bhavnagar state decided, the king of Bhavnagar, to develop a city in the outside. And state was giving loan to people without any perhaps interest or very little interest. So my father got this house made, and then in front of that there was a huge open area which was almost like arid land, and some opiums were getting up,
mm-hmm.
and all the kachra were dumped there. So he had this, because he had lived in a downtown area which was little better than slum, very crowded, and children had to play on streets the way they still play cricket here. So he thought there should be proper way for children to play, and that ground was very nice. So all the people who were member of his group, that Anand Mangal Mandal, they would work in that factory from morning to 5 or 6. Then they would come to this place, clean the thing, whatever was, they dug up, they filled it, cleaned, and started a kind of playground from children.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually it was a very disciplined thing, and lots of people were coming.
Mm.
It was started in 1939. It will be completing almost 75 years now this year. So then he got idea that there should be some summer classes. So in summer, because children were having vacations, so because they were all working in factory, they could come only after 5.
Yes.
So from 5:30 onward, there were simple things like certain things that would develop little physical thing,
mm-hmm.
Discipline and games.
Mm.
Then people would bring their own food. All children and those people.
Yes.
After meal, again there will be kind of entertainment where we were having garbas and songs, and somebody would always, whoever was invited would come and tell some stories or something
interactive sessions, yes.
Informative. I mean, we were all age group between 6 and 16, yes, mainly. Yes, you know, yes. Very few who were 15, 16, otherwise. Uh-huh. So, according to their level, so till 10, 10:30, then everyone had to sleep there in open. We had to guard this because it was kind of a very arid and surrounded by slums.
Absolutely,
no? So,
yes.
But it was also part of that discipline.
Yes.
That if something happens in family,
you take care of it,
we should learn, no, if we have to keep awake for 2 hours. So it was done. Everyone would have, no, for 2 hours, yeah. Four children would be in
on
charge.
Guard, yes.
Then they will wake up four others like that. Then again, early morning from 6 o'clock, more exercise and games and till 8, then some breakfast and they would go to factory, you know, like that.
So, like an alternative home during the...
Yes, for a whole month. And then at the end, they would take us some kind of a tour, which would be within some 30, 40 kilometers. So, walking, staying, cooking. So, no, living together was a part of it.
Absolutely.
We also had to collect some fund, no, because that first school that they had started in that slum was still on. It was also like this. No? Mm. I mean, just using school because
it
we learned
it,
so
yes.
much from these institutions.
Mm.
And so they were playing band during marriage. No, they had a small band which was also used for drills and exercise, but it was also used. And whenever if they had two orders, two places, then they would invite us. So I had played flute or drum and whatever. So we had learnt all these things too. So they would get some 5-10 rupees for the institution.
Of course, and the children would have been delighted to have been part of the whole thing.
Everything.
Yes.
And this included all kind of things. You know, somebody eventually introduced scouting, so a little more systematic scout groups, which is still going on. This is what Narendra Modi is doing today in front of cameras.
Yes.
This Swachhata Abhiyan. We had done it. Actually cleaned, no, because people were using footpaths because there were no latrines. I mean, no shauchalai devalai business there.
Sure.
So sometimes we would all go and clean.
Clean up the things.
That was, in fact, that's why perhaps I had made one painting when I was 12 years. You know, Harijan carrying dabba of, excretes.
Yes.
On head, because I had realized that that was the bad system we had.
Absolutely.
You know, huh?
Yes.
Though being a family of Brahmins, I mean, that term I had knew, so I knew that we were called Brahmins. But I had no idea what was Hindu. In fact, I thought Hindu was somebody like Muslim, somebody who was different. I didn't have any idea because that word sounded
alien.
So because from surrounding, and because one of my relatives, I mean, my father's some great aunt, or she was a widow and all alone. So whenever she was invited somewhere, she would take me with her.
That's her escort.
So that's why I knew that I was Brahmin. Otherwise, there was no that kind of a thing in. Though my father himself, he didn't believe in this kind of a rituals and puja. He never allowed my mother, he never stopped my mother from what she wanted to do. No? So we also had a puja. My mother had that, but we were never part of it. No?
What role does your mother play, or did your mother play? I know that she's still very much part of your life.
I think the greatest thing I think I have learned from her is her capacity to adopt all these things. She was coming from very orthodox family, very poor, even, we were not rich, but at least we had enough to eat.
generation.
I'm sure my mother didn't have that kind of a facility, you know, when she was. But she didn't mind whatever we were, you know, told to do.
She accepted it.
Yes, sir. People were coming who were not Brahmins, but using her own kitchen. I mean, we didn't have separate dining room or something, no. A small place for kitchen was also used for eating.
Yes.
So, and that's most holy for, no, yes. Orthodox Hindu,
yes,
family.
Yes.
Kitchen at least.
Absolutely.
But anybody could come, and my father always had, because of this institution. In fact, there was hardly any day when we didn't have guests coming and eating. You know. So I think that also made me that kind of a less rigid,
yes,
you know.
Yes.
There can be ideals, there can be optimum situations which I would love. But there can't be that everywhere and every time.
In every reality, yes.
So, you know, I have learned to have lots of leeway instead of
less,
very little. No, in engineering they have what they call tolerance factor,
absolutely,
which is in 2,000, 3,000, that is thousandth of a millimeter. No, instead of that I have 2 kilometers feet.
Yes.
It doesn't. No.
Sure.
I like clean things.
Yes.
But I have learned to live in ugliest and dirtiest place, because when I was traveling, otherwise it could have made my life miserable.
Jyoti Bhai, just as one's mother and father are absolutely influential in opening up worlds of experiences and influences, so too are our brothers and sisters, you know. So tell me a little bit about your siblings.
Though my father lived in a joint family, three uncles and their families, and so I had lots of aunts and uncles.
Mm-hmm.
Almost right from my early childhood, you know, I was living in with my father's house, you know, so I didn't have that kind of experience.
Mm-hmm.
And being the eldest in the family, it took time for me to realize this aspect. You know, I was more or less alone for first few years.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was 16, I had already, I came to Baroda.
That's right, yes.
So, in fact, when I came here, I had 4 or 5 brothers and sisters.
Mm-hmm.
And 3 or 4, I don't know how many, if I count, I wouldn't know when. We were born even later.
Okay.
So, I do not have that kind of a relationship, you know, that normally people would have.
Yes.
And often, especially my mother pointed out, you are the old one. You should do that, or you shouldn't do that, because now if younger one wants. So I remember I had lots of fights with my younger brother, because he was only 2 years younger, physically stronger than me. So, and I don't know how children feel, because 2 of my cousins, we were hardly, you know, 2 or 3 years difference.
Mm.
In fact, because this common, same, 3 aunts would have child more or less at the same time, you know, so 3 cousins, approximately same age.
Mm-hmm.
So, because of age group, we were very close friends, you know,
mm-hmm,
these 2 cousins and mine.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it so happened that I was the eldest, mm-hmm, in my family. Another one was middle,
okay,
and third one was the youngest.
Oh.
We were same age, but
in
and everyone had something,
yes,
to complain. What is the disadvantage of being elder, or who is,
yes,
neither elder, neither younger.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think it's very subjective.
Sure.
But eventually, in fact, I became more aware of my brothers and sisters after coming here. No? And 2 of my sisters had come here for study.
Mm-hmm.
Because my father thought they have had, you know, these 2 sisters had enough education, schooling rather. And there was no need for degree or something. No?
Mm-hmm.
On one hand, my father always had great respect for women, and in his institution, he had special classes, special thing for women.
Right.
He was almost like that character in Satyajit Rai's film Devi, where a daughter was like goddess, you know, or a sister or a woman was, you know, without being religious or orthodox. I mean, he respected, and I think he learnt it from Gandhiji. And also he must have learnt this very ancient something, you know, from Vedas or Upanishad. That where, so what is it, I don't know Sanskrit, but no, when women are worshipped, then the gods become very happy, or there is something, you know. But he had a great doubt about this college education or need for that, no.
For the women children.
And because though he was very open, he was so powerful that people never thought he was open. No, that I had that feeling. So I insisted that my sister should come to Baroda and study. You know, so two of sisters had come here and did their B.Ed. Though I was not here when they were here, but they lived in the room that I had.
And he accepted that. He was open to your.
So since then, and eventually, one of my sisters, her husband had a job in Mumbai in Tata Fundamental Research. He moved to Baroda. Then another brother who was working in Mumbai again moved to Baroda. And finally, the youngest brother also came. So we had four Bhatt families here. So then we became more close now. And one brother, in fact, when he was younger, when very young, and he wanted to come to Baroda to study fine arts, I never supported, you know, because I was there as a teacher. I thought, I couldn't push him. And saying, if I was in committee and if I had to reject, it would create very embarrassing position. No. So I never encouraged. And eventually my brother-in-law, that is Jyotsna's sister's husband, he took him to Mumbai and taught him screen printing.
Right.
And that's how, and eventually, then he came here because he was fed up with life of Mumbai. And Dumal gave him, a place to work. And he became expert screen printer.
In fact,
and eventually he took over the garba that we had started. Because he was so good at this.
Journeys have their own way and interspersing, so, absolutely.
And now, though he is here for last maybe 15 years, if I have any problem, he is my troubleshooter. Because he knows more about Baroda, more people, he has more influence, and cleverer because he has lived in Mumbai.